ശ്രീമതി ആർ പത്മാവതി, ഹെഡ് ഓഫ് ഡിപ്പാർട്ട്മെന്റ് ഇ സി ധനലക്ഷ്മി ശ്രീനിവാസൻ കോളേജ് ഓഫ് എഞ്ചിനീയറിംഗ് ആൻഡ് ടെക്നോളജി, ചെന്നൈ. She pursued her Bachelor of Engineering in Electronics and Instrumentation Engineering at the National Engineering College, Kovilpatti. She then went on to work as a technical editor in Domix Technical Information Private Limited, Chennai. She then pursued her Masters of Engineering in Applied Electronics at Satyabhama University, Chennai. She is currently pursuing her PhD in Anna University, Chennai. She has published several national and international journals and has attended many conferences. Her areas of interest include linear integrated circuits, digital electronics, electronic circuits, VLSI design.
Welcome to UGC lecture series BSc Electronics Honors for the subject Analog Electronics. Today we are going to discuss about the introduction to power amplifier, in which class B amplifier, power considerations, efficiency and power dissipation of class B amplifier, and crossover distortion, in which total harmonic distortion and power considerations are to be discussed. Power amplifier, and we have seen the introduction about the power amplifier in the last class. A power amplifier is a large signal amplifier, and this is generally a last stage of the multistage amplifier. So, in the the block diagram of the multistage amplifier is given here. So, the third stage, it is a driver stage in which class A amplifier is present. And the class A amplifier outputs the large version of the input signal, and so it drives the output stage in the in the multistage amplifier. So the output stage in the multistage amplifier is essentially a class B amplifier. The class B amplifier takes the is driven by the class A amplifier here. So, the class B amplifier is going to give you a maximum power output to drive the loudspeaker. So, when you compare the efficiency provided by the class A and class B amplifier, B has the highest efficiency, and so it is used in the output stage of most of the multistage amplifiers. So, we know that the power amplifier will amplify the signal in the smaller range to a larger version of the at the output in the range of 1 watts to tens of watts, and so it is a large signal amplifier also. It is called a large signal amplifier. So, for the large signal amplifiers, the bias point is very important. We know that the bias point has to be located at the AC load line. So, what is the AC load line? It is based on the AC load of the circuit. An AC load line will not follow the DC load line because both the loads are different. The DC load is different from the AC load. The AC load line is ICQ saturation to VCE cutoff. This is the AC load line. And without the AC signal, what is the load we have to calculate, and we have to locate the voltage when IC is 0 and locate the current when VC is 0. So, we got 2 points on the output characteristic curve of the amplifier, and this will give you the DC load line. So, both are different, and at the midpoint in this particular graph, we locate the bias point of the power amplifier, and so it is a ICQ, and the corresponding voltage is the VCQ. So, if this is the bias point at the mid of the AC load line, this is the output characteristics of the particular power amplifier. So, here on the AC load line, the Q point is selected at the center, and so the output voltage has a maximum swing from 0 to 360 degree, and also the output current has a maximum swing for 0 to 360 degree of the input signal. This is another example of how to draw the AC load line from this particular circuit. This resistance RC is the load resistance in the if the input signal is given, AC signal is given, and this RC is calculated from the parallel combination of the collector resistance and the load resistance, and this is the effective output load for this particular circuit, and from this small RC, we have to obtain the saturation current as well as the VCE voltage. So when you got these two points, then if you connect these two points on the output characteristics of the power amplifier, you will be getting the AC load line. So now we for the power amplifiers, as we discussed earlier, the bias point, the location of the bias point is very important for the output to be produced. So if the Q point, that is the bias point, is located below the midpoint of the AC load line. See here in this output characteristics, this is just an example. In this output characteristics, if the bias point Q is located or selected below the midpoint of the AC load line, what will happen at the output for the voltage? So some portion of the voltage is clipped off, and the if the bias point is selected below the midpoint of the AC load line, the input drives the transistor to the cutoff region. So the output, some part of the output is clipped off. So what will happen if the bias point is located or selected above the center point on the AC load line? So in this case, the input signal drives the transistor, power transistor, towards the saturation part, saturation region. We know that in the output characteristics, where is the saturation region and where is the cutoff region and where is the active region, we have discussed earlier. So in this case, if the Q point is above the midpoint on the DC AC load line, the input drives the power transistor to the saturation region, and so again the output current as well as output voltage will be clipped off at its peak. So normally, if you want to have a maximum voltage as well as the maximum current without any clipping, then you have to select the load line, you have to select the Q point at the midpoint of the AC load line. So when you look at this graph, it is selected at the middle of the AC load line, and so we obtain the maximum peaks at the voltage as well as at the current, the output current ICQ as well as the output voltage VCEQ. So this is the condition for the, this has happened in the followed in the class A power amplifier, and so the output voltage has the maximum swing from 0 to 360 degree for the full cycle of the input. And what is class B amplifier and how it is it has been differentiated from the class A amplifier? So again, this is a power transistor. We know that this is not a normal transistor. This is a power transistor. It has the maximum power handling capacity, and so it is applicable in the power amplifier. This is the circuit for class B amplifier. As I said, the bias point of any amplifier, if you take, the bias point is very important. The location of the bias point classifies the power amplifiers. So for the class A amplifier, we have seen the bias point is located at the middle of the AC load line. For class B amplifier, the bias point is located at the cutoff region on the AC load line. So when it is located at the cutoff, if the input signal Vi and plus the base voltage, say it is Vb, this voltage, if you add this input signal, and if it is less than 0.7 volt, that is the voltage you have to apply for the silicon transistor to make the transistor in conduction region. So if this voltage is less than the 0.7 volt, then this transistor goes to cutoff and it will not produce any output. And if it is positive, then the transistor conducts and it gives you the output for 0 to 180 degree. So only for one half of the input signal, for the other half, this transistor is cut off, and so there is no output. So the output has the swing from 0 to 180 degree for the full cycle of the input signal. So we didn't get output for the negative half of the input signal. If you want to get it, then you have to use another class B amplifier in the push-pull configuration, or you can say it is a complementary symmetry configuration of power amplifier. So it is also referred as push-pull or complementary symmetry configuration, here in which there are two class B amplifiers, one for getting an output for the positive half of the input signal, the other one is for the negative half of the input signal. And this is the circuit. Here two power supplies are used, plus VCC and minus VCC. These two power supply is symmetrical DC voltage, and the voltage across this base emitter, if VBE1 is higher than 0.7, then this Q1 is the transistor in the configuration NPN type, this will on, and Q2 is of type PNP. So, how do you differentiate NPN and PNP configuration? So, according to the arrow mark present at the emitter terminal of the transistor, you can easily know which one is the NPN type and which one is the PNP type. So, here the arrow is outward, so it is NPN type of configuration, this Q1 is NPN and this Q2 has an arrow towards the base, so it is a PNP type of configuration. So, the base emitter voltage VBE1 biases the transistor Q1, and if it is greater than 0.7, Q1 is on, and if it is less than 0.7, it is off, Q1 is off. Similarly, here it is a PNP type of configuration, this Q2. So, this VBE has to be less than minus 0.7, you have to give a negative voltage to make this transistor on. So, VBE2 has to be minus 0.7 volt for Q2 to be on, and if it is reverse, then Q2 will be in off state. So, here Vin, the input voltage is given to both the bases of the transistors Q1 and Q2, and the output is taken across the emitter terminal of Q1 and Q2 through the load resistance RL. So, what will happen if the input voltage, the AC signal Vin is equal to 0? If Vin is 0, no voltage is given at the base of the transistors, and so both the transistors will be in cutoff region, and so the output is 0. Output is 0. And if Vin is positive, and it is greater than 0.7 volt, then we know that the transistor Q1 will be in on state, and it conducts current from the supply to ground through the load resistance. So, in this way the current is flowing from VCC to the ground through the resistance RL, and at that time this Q2 will be off, because this Vin is positive and it is more positive, it is greater than 0.7. And if Vin is less than minus 0.7, this Q1 is off and Q2 will be in on state, and it conducts current from the ground to the supply minus VCC through the load resistance RL. So, for the previous case, if the current is flowing from the supply to the ground through the resistance RL, it sources the current, and for Q2 to be on, it sinks the current from the ground to the negative supply VCC. And you can also say it is a push and pull combination, pushing the current to the ground and pulling the current from the ground to the supply, and so it is called as push-pull configuration. And also you can say it is a complementary symmetry, because both the transistors are identical in its electrical characteristics, Q1 and Q2, but the difference is it is an NPN configuration, it is a PNP configuration, and so it is a complementary symmetry. Complementary symmetry configuration. Okay. So, we have seen the output of the circuit when the input voltage is 0, and when the input voltage is positive, and when the input voltage is negative. So, what is the output when the input voltage is positive? It is Vin minus VBE1. Here, if the input signal is positive, this Q2 is cut off. So, the loop is only from here, the input and the transistor and the output through the resistance RL. So, the output voltage is taken across the RL as Vin minus VBE1, and if the input voltage is negative, and this Q1 is cut off, and so the loop is from here. So, this Vin and this part, base emitter voltage of Q2 and the load resistance RL. So, at that time Vout is Vin plus VBE2. Vin plus VBE2 is your output voltage. Okay, what will happen if the input voltages is in between minus 0.7 to 0.7. So, we are giving input voltage, but at that time the transistors will be off. It produces a dead band condition, and if it is off, then there is no output even if the input is present. Even if the input is present, there is no output because both the transistors are off if the input voltage is in between minus 0.7 volt to plus 0.7 volt. So, this is the dead band because of which the output is 0. Both the transistors are in cutoff region and output is 0, and this is the distortion present at its output of class B amplifier, and this is the disadvantage of the class B amplifier also. Okay, so how will you overcome this situation? So, you have to again think over the biasing of the transistor. You have to choose the biasing point in such a way that both the transistors has to be in conduction state even when the input signal is 0 or for a small input signal. So, we will see this particular type of circuit in the next session. Now, we have to discuss about this crossover distortion. So, we know that this crossover distortion is present at the output of the class B amplifier when both the transistors are off. If both the transistors are off, this case is present when the input signal is very, very, very small, that is in between minus 0.7 to 0.7. So, how will you overcome this and how do you calculate this crossover distortion? Okay, this crossover distortion is significant if the input signal is very, very small, and it contributes to the total harmonic distortion. An effective method for reducing the crossover distortion involves the selection of bias points for transistors Q1 and Q2. So, rather than designing for the conduction times of exactly 1/2 cycle, that is for class B. So, we have designed the conduction time for class B as 1/2 cycle from 0 to 180 degree. But if the design is made for the transistor conduction times that are slightly longer than 1/2 cycle, that is slightly above the cutoff region. If the bias point is slightly above the cutoff region, then the circuit is said to be, in that case the circuit is said to be class AB amplifier. So, if you study this class AB amplifier, we come to know that the crossover distortion can be reduced at the output. Other important design considerations for complementary symmetry, that is for class B as well as for class AB amplifiers, because this class AB amplifier is again just the selection of the Q point with the same class B amplifier. So, we have to select the Q point in such that both the transistors are on even for a no input signal, slightly above the cutoff. So, this class AB amplifier is again, it is a complementary symmetry configuration. So, for this particular circuit, the design consideration is for careful matching of NPN and PNP transistor electrical characteristics. So, for both the NPN and PNP transistor, the electrical characteristics must be matched. Any asymmetry of the positive or negative portions of the output waveform also contributes to the total harmonic distortion of the output signal. And in the case of power, the power supplied to the load, the power provided by the DC voltage sources and dissipated in the transistors. We have to consider all these factors to avoid the crossover distortion in this complementary symmetry push-pull configuration, even in class B as well as in the class AB amplifiers. So, now we have to see what is the efficiency of the class B amplifier, and we know that the class B amplifier's output is swinging from 0 to 180 degree only, and from 180 to 360 degree the output is 0. So, for 1/2 of the input cycle the output is 0, the circuit is off, and so the power dissipation is very less, and so the efficiency is high when you compare it with the class A amplifier, where the efficiency is only 25% if it is a resistive load, and if it is a transformer load then the efficiency is only 50% in as theoretical value for class A amplifier. So we will see what is the value for class B amplifier. So this is the input power. You can write it as the input power is only DC power. So without any input signal, without any AC signal, you have to calculate the power, and that is VCC into IDC. And IDC can be, if it is taken from the peak voltage, peak current, it is 2 by pi I peak, that is the maximum current. And when you substitute it, you will be getting VCC 2 by pi IP. The output power is, when the input signal is given, what is the output power? What is the power delivered to the load? So, power, output power AC is given as V square L RMS by RL. It is related with the load. And this can be written from the peak to peak voltage as well as from the peak voltage, as we have seen in the class A amplifier. And we know what is the input power, what is the output power, and efficiency is the ratio of the output power delivered to the load to the input power from taken from the DC supply. So when you substitute, the value you can obtain is 78.5%. And this VLP, if you take it as VCC also, you will be getting 78.5% as the maximum efficiency for class B amplifier. So it is increased in increased more than 25% from when you compare it with the class A amplifier. What is the power dissipated by the output transistors? So, power dissipation, because we have used two transistors in the push-pull configuration, it is P2Q. Power dissipation is represented as P2Q, and it is nothing but the difference between the power input power and the output power, the power delivered and the input power. So, for a single transistor, it can be taken as P2Q by 2, the half of it is the single transistor power dissipation value. The maximum power considerations, if the peak voltage is considered to be the supply voltage. So, we know that the supply voltage is the maximum voltage we can obtain from any transistor, even for a small signal amplifier as well as for a large signal amplifier. The supply voltage is the maximum voltage you can obtain at its output. So, VLP, if it is taken as the maximum voltage as VCC, then the maximum output power is written as V square CC by 2 RL. And for the current, if you replace this IP in terms of VCC, you will be getting this term. And from this, you can obtain the input power as 2 V square CC by pi RL. And again, if you calculate the efficiency, it will be around 78.54%. If you consider the maximum power, it is again 78.54. When the input signal results in less than the maximum output signal swing, the circuit efficiency is less than 78.5%. If the input signal itself is reduced, then the output signal is reduced, and so the efficiency is less than 78.5%. The maximum power dissipation, it does not occur at the maximum power input or output condition. The maximum power dissipation is occurred at the output when the input DC supply is 0.636 times of VCC. So, it is 2 by pi VCC, and so the dissipation, power dissipation for the two transistors is calculated as 2 V square CC by pi squared RL. Okay, now we have seen class B amplifier's efficiency from the push-pull combination of the transistors, or you can say it is a complementary symmetry transistors. So, it is one way of having a class B amplifier. There are other methods to have a class B amplifier using a transformer, using an operational amplifier having two opposite outputs, or using a few op-amp stages. And the last one we have seen now, if it is a transformer coupled push-pull circuits, this is the circuit diagram for class B amplifier. Input side you have to, there is a transformer, and the output also there is a transformer which drives the speaker. So, this is a center trapped transformer. If the input signal is positive, one of the transistors will be in on and other the other one will be off. So the on the if the transistor Q1 is on, the current will flow for the primary of the transistor as I1, and if the transistor Q2 is on, then at that time Q1 is off. So through the transistor Q2, I2 will be flowing to the primary of the transformer, and so at a time only one of the transistor is on, and so the current I1 and I2 will flow through the load to drive the speaker or a loudspeaker. So there are two transformers at the input side, one transformer is employed, and at the output side also another transformer is employed to split the signals and to make the transistor simultaneously on and off, and the output will be swinging from 0 to 360 degree. The transistor Q1 is for 0 to 180 degree output, and from 180 to 360 degree Q2 is taking the charge. And this is the circuit for transformer coupled push pull circuit amplifier. And whatever the circuit may be, we know that if the transistors are off, that is we have seen there is a disadvantage in the class B amplifier, and it is a crossover distortion. So this is the graph, you can see the crossover distortion at the graph. So this is the curve for two transistor Q1 on and Q2 off, and here the negative half is produced for Q1 off and Q2 on. So this dead band which creates the crossover distortion, why it is called as crossover distortion is the transistor whenever the transistor crosses over from on to off state or from off to on state, you have a dead band at its output, and because of this dead band there is a distortion at the output. So it is called as a crossover distortion. And if input signal is very small, this crossover distortion leads to the total harmonic distortion. What is a amplifier distortion? It is due to the non-linearity of the devices present in the amplifier. A pure sinusoidal signal has a single frequency at which the voltage varies positive and negative by equal amounts. This is a pure sinusoidal signal. Any signal varying over less than full 360 degree is considered to have a distortion. So if the output signal varies over less than 360 degree, there comes the distortion. The frequency distortion is if an idle amplifier is give you a larger version of the input signal at one particular frequency with maximum amplitude, then it is the amplified version of the input signal. If the amplifier gives you frequency component more than one, then it is a distorted output, and this distortion is said to be a frequency distortion. And you have to call the first component, frequency component, as the fundamental component, and the other frequency component as harmonics or harmonic components. So this is a simple example to know what is a fundamental component and what are the harmonics. A signal that is originally 1 kilohertz or it is a 1000 hertz could result after distortion in a frequency component at it is a fundamental component 1000 hertz, that is 1 kilohertz, and harmonics at 2 kilohertz, 3 kilohertz and so on. So the original frequency of 1 kilohertz is called the fundamental frequency, and those at integral multiples are the harmonics. That is, the 2 kilohertz component is therefore called a second harmonic, 3 kilohertz is third harmonic, and so on. The fundamental frequency is not considered a harmonic. So how will you calculate the harmonic distortion present in the output? A signal is considered to have harmonic distortion when there are harmonic frequency components, not just the fundamental frequency. So if the signal has, instead of having 1 kilohertz, if it contains 1k, 2k, 3k, then the signal contains the harmonics, and we can calculate the harmonic distortion as per this formula. If the fundamental frequency has an amplitude an and nth frequency component has an amplitude, if the fundamental has A1 amplitude and nth frequency has An amplitude, then the harmonic distortion can be calculated as in as the modulus of nth amplitude and first amplitude into 100%. The total harmonic distortion is calculated as per this formula. When an output signal has a number of individual harmonic distortion, the signal can be seen to have a total harmonic distortion based on the individual elements as combined by the relationship of the following equation. So, we know how to calculate the D2, D3, D4. Why it is not D1? Because D1 is the fundamental frequency. So, you can calculate the distortion for the second, third, fourth and so on harmonics, and to finally, if you take the root square, the square sum of the square of the harmonic distortion and over the square root, this is to be the total harmonic distortion. So, to analyze these the total harmonic distortion, you can use the spectrum analyzer and wave analyzer, and fundamentally the frequency distortion can be studied by using a Fourier transform. Frequency distortion at the periodic signals can be studied by using a Fourier transform. So, second harmonic is the major part in the frequency distortion. So, this is a distorted signal, it is shown here. And there are 3 points located. At these 3 points, if you put the angle as well as the amplitude. So, this is the angle is 0 here at the first point, and at the second point the angle is 90 degree, and third point it is 180 degree. So, if you put these angles in the frequency component, and if you put replace the amplitude as 1 at the point 1 and 0 at point 2 and minus 1 at point 3 in the basic equation of the frequency distorted signal, then you will be getting 3 equations for point 1, point 2, point 3. So, this is the equation for frequency distorted signal. So, when you look at this, this is the ICQ is the normal output. I naught is the fundamental component, and these are the harmonics. Frequency at point 1, and pi by 2 is the frequency at point 2, and pi is the frequency at point 3. When you substitute the values of these frequency, you will be getting 3 equations, and solving this you are getting ID I naught, I 2 and I 1. So, from this you can calculate the second harmonic distortion. Since this is a very major part, you have to consider for the harmonic distortion. So, in terms of VCE and in terms of IC, you can calculate it. And if the signal is having a frequency distortion, this is the power calculation in terms of the total harmonic distortion. So, we have seen today the class B amplifier in push-pull configuration, in which the power considerations, efficiency and the power dissipation we have calculated. And what is the crossover distortion we have discussed, in which the total harmonic distortion and power considerations, if the signal has a frequency, fundamental frequency as well as the harmonics present, we have discussed the power considerations. Explain in brief class B amplifier in push-pull configuration. What is complementary symmetry combination of transistors? What is crossover distortion, and how do you calculate the harmonic distortion? These are the references. Thank you.